Thanks to Rocket Money for sponsoring today's video. More on them later. What are the chances you know Blippi? Because given the sheer size of his channel, I'd say it's extremely likely you've come across this blue and orange hat wearing man. Especially if you have younger siblings, or if you have kids yourself, or maybe for some reason you enjoy watching children's content. If you've never heard of Blippi, well, that's no problem, because I'll do my best to introduce you to this man right here. Yeah, this dude? He averages over 100 million monthly views on YouTube. He can be described as using his whirlwind of energy and bright colors to keep millions of three-year-olds out there glued to their YouTube screens. Simply browse through his videos and you'll definitely see how he does it. He just reeks of fun and learning around any imaginable kid's topic, from jungle animals, indoor playgrounds, Halloween songs, to museums, aquariums, and rather oddly, even NASCAR racing. And you've really gotta believe me when I say this dude's popular, because he has 935 million views on just one video. And in classic kids fashion, it's about an obscure, I guess not that obscure topic, it's jungle animals. Kids really rule the internet, don't they? Anyway, we'll come back to his success later in the video. What I want to focus on this video is the disgusting past of everyone's best friend, Blippi, who's actually gone through some great lengths to keep his past hidden. It actually has come as a surprise to many that Blippi, real name Stephen John, hasn't always been the child's hero we see today. Before setting off to start the Blippi YouTube channel back in 2014 and becoming the huge success he is, Stephen John, who by the way changed his legal name from Stevin J. Grossman, had a much different life in Los Angeles. He was a filmmaker and created content that, let's just say, was not family friendly. Like, at all. He played this persona called Steezy Grossman, and what he did was make films that have been termed low budget and lowbrow, with titles like Turd Boy and The Underwear Man. One of the things I'm talking about is his R-rated twist on the Harlem Shake meme. The Harlem Shake poop video, where he poops on his friend in the video. He poops on his friend in the video. Obviously, I'm not gonna show that. But hold your horses, guys. We're gonna get there, okay? This is just the intro of the video. It's insane to think that the same person who found that funny is currently the roller coaster of all things fun and education for kids from all over the world. With all that being said, let's get into it. Let's take a deep dive into how this filmmaker, who was a custodian of extremely horrifying humor, transformed into a really loved children's entertainer. We'll also be taking a look at what parents think of him now that his past is no longer hidden. And now, a quick word from our sponsor. I recently found out I was being charged monthly for Hulu at 18 bucks. I don't even use Hulu. I was also being charged for Peacock TV and a bunch of other services I had forgotten I subscribed to. If only there was a way all my subscriptions could be sorted out neatly and I was given quick and easy options to cancel all my unwanted memberships. Oh wait, today's sponsor, Rocket Money, is here to help. This personal finance app allows you to manage subscriptions, lower bills, make a custom budget, and grow your savings all in one place. I love using Rocket Money to cancel unwanted subscriptions safely and securely. You can even cancel within the app with just a couple of taps. No need to worry about customer service calls or websites hiding the cancel subscription button in the most obscure place on their website. Nah. Rocket Money has helped save its customers an average of $720 a year, with over $500 million in canceled subscriptions. If you want to save more and spend less, join the over 5 million members using Rocket Money today. Go to rocketmoney.com/tuv or click the link in the description to get started for free. Thanks again to Rocket Money for sponsoring this video, and now let's get back to the topic. Blippi's empire explained. The appropriate place to start is the castle that Blippi has built. I'm not talking a literal castle, I'm talking about his financial castle. The obvious part we've already talked about is that Blippi is popular among children. And that's not because his content covers singing, dancing, playing, and exploring, all of which are exciting for kids. Rather, it's because he found a really engaging way to answer questions that kids find puzzling. His channel's description tells it all, as he states, "Come explore the wondrous world with everybody's best friend, Blippi. How does a recycling truck work? What does a baker do? What is the best playground around? There are many exciting things to explore and learn." Now, before we go even further on his style, let's take a look at his numbers. He is currently at 19.2 million subscribers with 829 total videos posted. That's on his main channel, Blippi Educational Videos for Kids. Those are highly impressive figures on their own, but he has two more channels. Blippi Toys, which has 11.3 million subscribers and just over 700 uploaded videos, and Blippi Español, which has a whopping 16.2 million subscribers and just about 663 videos. videos. That's a combined 46.7 million YouTube subscribers and combined 2,200 videos. Together, these channels have earned him about 37 billion total views. To put that into perspective, that's almost as much as Mr. Beast's main channel. That one has 41 billion views. Being curious about his income, I checked on Social Blade and found the estimation to be anywhere between 30,000 and 475,000 in monthly YouTube earnings. But take that with a grain of salt, because money determination on those types of websites isn't really that accurate. It's just to get a ballpark estimate. But that doesn't go to say, if you're seeing those kinds of views, you're definitely seeing a pretty penny. Now, with these figures in mind, let's go back to his style. I think what sets Blippi apart, as I already mentioned, is that he found an engaging way to talk about things kids care about. His content is undoubtedly colorful, high energy, and educational all rolled into one. All videos start out with his catchy tune, so much to learn about, it'll make you want to shout Blippi. And right from the start, his clown adjacent dressing, the high-pitched voice, playful music, and constant pop-ups as he explains stuff would probably be irresistible to any three-year-old. I mean, I don't know what to tell you. He seems pretty good at what he does. I won't even talk about the production quality because it's sort of expected from a channel that size. Actually, I should mention that Blippi as a brand was acquired by a company called Moonbug back in 2020, and Moonbug isn't a tiny company. It has over 309 employees and could afford to pay $120 million for Blippi and Cocomelon. So yeah, no surprise in the production quality at all. It's also not surprising that Blippi would have a whole host of merchandise readily available for his audience. Just a quick search on Amazon and there's an endless variety of Blippi stuff, from toys, clothing, books, to even the TV show. Their Amazon storefront also looks pretty nice, I'd say. And there's more. For example, they do city tours with tickets costing about $25 and have even collaborated with Liverpool FC for an event and special edition merch. Yeah, the football club. Also, if Blippi looks different, that's because he is. We'll get to that. I haven't even mentioned all the commercial Blippi inspired stuff out there that Steven John and his team are not profiting from. Honestly, it's quite an empire this dude has built in just 10 years. And while at it, he has of course gotten the attention of many, given media features in CBS News, Forbes, Mashable, and others. The 2017 to 2018 period particularly earned him lots of recognition by the media for reasons only the kids' channel gods may know. It's money and numbers. All those articles I've shown you are from that time. I might as well throw it in here that some moms had, or maybe still have, the hots for Blippi. In a now deleted thread in a Reddit mom group, someone posts, "Does anyone else want to Blippi? Way to sexualize the thing your kids watch." Anyway, while browsing articles written about him, I found an interesting reason why he was able to start the Blippi channel so successfully. But before we get to that, let's switch gears and get into his really weird backstory. A weird backstory. Let me begin by reminding you that Steven John changed his legal name from Stephen J. Grossman. It's therefore very likely that anyone who knows him as Steven John wouldn't be able to recognize him from his Steezy Grossman persona. It's no wonder that BuzzFeed put it this way. While some may have seen Blippi throw the first pitch at a 2018 Arizona Diamondbacks game, they've almost certainly never heard of Steezy Grossman. So first, let's clear the question. Why was Steven making films? Turns out he went to UCLA Extension to study cinematography and film production, and so he was right within his alley with the acting and filming stuff. The problem is, with his Steezy Grossman persona, he chose a rather odd route and adult-rated route to take. He was a turd boy. You heard that right, a turd boy. In a fake trailer for a film called Turd Boy, Steezy plays a role that is hard to describe, not because of its complexity, but rather its nastiness. Basically, it's about getting pregnant from anal sex, and then the baby comes out, but it's half poop, half human, so it's called Turd Boy, and the whole little skit fake trailer video he made is about the kid, I guess, getting bullied and going through life and its troubles, and it's like him covered in makeup prosthetics of poop, so it's pretty gross. And apparently he was really proud of this accomplishment, saying, "Good times filming this thing. Crew was amazing. Cast was awesome. And I can't say enough, it was awesome making out with Carolina." Isn't it surprising the kind of film festivals they had back then? I mean, if I read it right, there was a 2012 International Ship Movie Film Festival. The other one was the 2012 Machinima Interactive Film Festival. Out of curiosity, I actually tried to find out what the International Ship Movie Film Festival was all about, and I found this interesting set of regulations where, among other things, they required submission to be odd. For example, they say, "The art of, quote, bad on purpose, end quote, is exciting to us. And think outside the box. We like weird, zany, and insane shit." Anyway, going back to Steezy, a quick search on the Internet Archive will show you that these roles were nothing new to him. For instance, I found that he also did Pee Troubles, Dick Genie, and Underwear Man. So yeah, pretty strong choice of content, definitely leaning more towards the NSFW side. Unsurprisingly though, that turd theme would later feature in his other shenanigans, such as the Harlem Shake poop. The Harlem Shake poop.
All right, so before we talk about his twist on the Harlem Shake, let's talk about the Harlem Shake. That is, if you somehow didn't hear about it in 2012. I don't know. Some of you born in 2012? I have no idea. Basically, it was a dance that came from a song. But we're gonna take a closer look at it just to really show you how far Steven went with this thing. So, as already mentioned, the whole thing was originated from a song. A track titled Harlem Shake by American DJ and producer, Bauer. This heavy bass instrumental track, though released in 2012, later grew wildly popular and it sparked the dance series in 2013. Not to say that the dance didn't exist before, but it was definitely popularized with this trend. In the song, there's a lyric, "Now do the Harlem Shake." And that's where, like, everyone just goes crazy, woo! But before the lead up, or I guess during the lead up, it's usually one person dancing, you know, they look a little awkward. You're watching the video, you're like, damn, this dude's pretty awkward. Unless you already know what's gonna happen, which is like 99% of the universe. But then the do the Harlem Shake voice. I sound so stupid saying this. Then the beat drops, okay? And then everyone goes crazy. So that's a little throwback. And yes, that is Joji in that pink morph suit. Totally a fact that no one knew that. I'm the first person to find out that Joji was in that pink morph suit. So don't you dare comment saying that you already knew that, right? That was definitely a fact. No one likes spamming in comments of videos. You can definitely see why Urban Dictionary defined the dance as an electric upper body dance move that involves the shaking of your upper torso and shoulders. I have to admit, I went down the Harlem Shake rabbit hole. Yes, there's a Harlem Shake rabbit hole. It's a rabbit hole for anything. And I found some pretty odd origins. I found this obviously fake definition, but I thought I'd share it with you guys. That its true origin came from 125th and Lexington, New York, where gangsters would shoot unsuspecting crippled people with crutches and the staggering fall of these people would become the dance. Yeah, this is just some internet bullshit. Although to be fair, there is a different version of its origin story, which is a lot more believable, where it's believed that the dance was invented by a guy known as Al B to imitate drunk people. Anyway, as the dance got introduced to local parties in Harlem, it just started becoming a thing. And it went viral for sure. Extremely viral. There's a whole compilation of people in the office, people in the army, mascots, you know, the WWE, just doing this trend. It was honestly, it was a good time in history. I miss that. I even made one as a kid, though that is lost media. I did find a video of me dancing as a banana at 9 years old. I'm a banana, I'm a banana, I'm a banana. Look at me move, yeah, yeah. I'm a banana, I'm a banana. Look at me move, yeah, yeah. Banana power, banana power. Stop. All right, I don't know how to transition to the next topic, but let's get to the next section. Now, going back to our guy, Steven, he decided he wanted to be a part of this trend, but in a very unique way. He called his version the Harlem Shake poop. And because I can't show the video, I'll try my best to describe it without getting demonetized. So the scene is set in a normal bathroom. He's sitting on the toilet with his pants down to his ankles, and he's wearing a cycling helmet and some goggles. And you know, the song is building up, the classic Harlem Shake buildup, and he's dancing. There's no one else in the toilet with him or in the room, the bathroom. And then it's like, do the Harlem Shake. And extremely gross warning here. He then diarrheas onto his friend who's laying upside down on the ground. It's like a missile of brown. So definitely not showing that, but it's a real video. I watched it and it is Blippi. It's our boy Blippi, you know, pre-blip. God. Yep, morbid documentaries, guys. This is what we do here. Oh, did I mention that his friend was also butt naked? Well, he was. Again, saying that the video is gross is, it's an understatement. As this Redditor put it, that was 1,000 times worse than whatever I thought it would be. Now, this side of Blippi may have remained hidden if it wasn't for a BuzzFeed article. Yeah, BuzzFeed of all companies were the people that brought this to light. To be specific, it was a BuzzFeed article from 2019. And in the classic style of media, the story was published over and over and over again by other publishing medias. And of course, it was all over social media, like this Reddit post, some YouTube videos talking about it. The aftermath was also in the form of pushback by some parents. This article, for example, suggests that some parents would need therapy to, quote, cope with the news that Blippi shat on someone, end quote. Another article details the response from a mom of two in Virginia who said, "This kind of changes the game for me as far as letting my kids watch his videos. It just feels weird to know that he participated in these disgusting acts and has now shifted his focus to working with children. We wouldn't let a teacher with that background work with kids. Why would a child entertainer be any different? Using copyright laws to hide the dark past." So again, just so we're on the same page here, in 2019, BuzzFeed revealed his past. And what did Blippi do? Well, he and slash or his team filed a DMCA copyright infringement claim against BuzzFeed to not publish the video anywhere. And a DMCA claim, for anyone who might not know, allows a person, the copyright holder, to get someone else, like a website, to take down user-uploaded material that belongs to the copyright holder. So in our case, Steven was the owner of the Harlem Shake poop video and used the copyright law to get BuzzFeed to not publish the video anywhere. It also turns out that he didn't only send a legal notice of infringement to BuzzFeed, he also sent it to Google after a Russian website hosted it and Google indexed it. A Vice article also clarifies that in an interview, Blippi said that it wasn't the BuzzFeed report that prompted his response. Rather, he had already been doing that for years whenever it popped up somewhere online. He specifically said, "It wasn't BuzzFeed's reporting that led me to try to get the video taken down. I've been doing that for years, pretty much whenever and wherever I find it up somewhere." He also came after the Vice people a little bit, saying, "Filing a takedown notice hardly qualifies as going to, quote, extreme lengths." I don't know, man. I think it's pretty extreme. I don't know if you think that, Blippi. Poop man. I'm gonna call you poop man for the rest of the video. And I'm not. Now, winding back a bit to the DMCA part, you can see that on the takedown request sent to Google, the original URL is specified as harlemshakepoop.com. Why is that important to know? Well, I want you to get a sense of how committed Blippi was to going viral. Having a dedicated website means that Blippi wanted people to visit it. More on that later. Anyway, thanks to the unforgetting nature of the internet, you can actually look it up. I'm not encouraging you to do that, but you can look that up on Google and it pops up right there on the Internet Archive. Again, I'm not recommending that. No, don't do that. That was just an educational statement. This is an educational video, guys. So, YouTube reviewer, if you're watching this is an educational video about a weird topic. But anyway, what happened after all this information came out? Well, Blippi responded. So let's get to what he said. Blippi's apology and transformation. Let's actually start with his response to the BuzzFeed article, because that's where most of the information about the poop saga comes from. In a statement to BuzzFeed, he said, "At the time, I thought this sort of thing was funny, but really it was stupid and tasteless, and I regret having ever done it." He also said, "I've grown up a lot since then, and I trust people will see me as the person I am now, not the idiot I was back then." That response has two things that it communicates strongly. One is that he obviously regrets his past, and two, he's alluding to the fact that he's changed as a person. However, like a shadow, his past keeps lingering and there's no real way to shake it off. In fact, a good way to perceive this is to think of what our community now insinuated. Should John's checkered history determine the fate of his beloved character Blippi? In other words, should bad history mean that a person can never change? This is a topic that we've actually talked about in my YouTubers That Ruin Their Lives video, specifically the Shane Dawson part, because these are people that have done really horrible things. Blippi was just disgusting. I don't think he like hurt anyone, but believing in growth, you know, if you want to believe in that someone has grown, that's on you. But usually there is evidence, you know, if this dude hasn't done anything crazy in 10 years, it's more than likely that he's changed, but you know, we'll never know behind closed doors. Steven's lawyer actually put it as, "It was a consensual, non-sexual poop joke. No one got hurt. It's not sexist or criminal or problematic. It's just pure jackass prank stupidity." Blippi also responded to the Vice article about his use of copyright law to bury his past. Again, he emphasized that he was regretful of having made the poop video or even finding that kind of entertainment funny. He said, "Although I thought stuff like the Harlem Shake poop video was funny when I was in my early 20s, these days I'm really embarrassed that I ever did anything as stupid and gross as that." He even took a jab at the journalistic standards of both Vice and BuzzFeed. He implied that Vice, and I've already mentioned this, was inaccurate for saying he went to extreme lengths to try to get the video taken down after the BuzzFeed article came out. He suggested that BuzzFeed's article was not, quote, a blockbuster investigative report, end quote, as Vice phrased it. And the sheer fact that Vice thought that was true was reflective of deteriorating journalistic standards. Basically, I think he was just trying to tell him that y'all hyped up this video of me pooping And it's not worth the hype. But Blippi, let me tell you something, it is worth the hype. It is. In fact, there are parents who are still on his side, even after discovering his past. Our Community Now reported, for some parents, the apology is sincere, and the benefits of Blippi outweigh his past history. One parent, for instance, speaking to BuzzFeed, said, "Do I want my kid to go and give him a hug? Probably not. But I also don't want to deprive my kid of his construction videos that have actually really helped boost his language skills. I just might not watch that Chocolate Factory video again." I don't know exactly which video she's referring to, but I'm willing to bet this one. Anyway, the point is that even after some parents discover his past, they're not going to go through the effort to cancel him. And this is obviously kind of true given his growth in the past couple of years. At the time that BuzzFeed published our article, the channel was at about 3.6 million YouTube subscribers, and that number has now grown to 19.2 million. And his other channels have also experienced a similar trend. There's a chance growth means people love him, right? Viral strategy using past skills. Now, while that poop stuff is a major controversy, that isn't the only thing that puts people off when it comes to Blippi. For example, there's an entire Reddit thread framing him as just a guy after money with no care for the children he's supposed to be entertaining. The thread, which could be just a rant to be fair, mentions that Blippi seems obsessed with brand growth given how he's always emphasizing the kids to spell out his name and search it online, sort of drilling his brand into their young minds.
"But if you want to watch more of my videos, all you have to do is search for my name. Will you spell my name with me? Ready? B-L-I-P-P-I. Blippi, good job."
The thread also mentions an interview where Blippi talked a lot about his approach at the beginning of his content journey, including living in LA for 6 years and learning skills like online content marketing. There's also a mentioning of the bewildering large merchandising operation that he runs. And again, his prior skill set and career path have nothing to do with kids. Now, take all this information with a grain of salt because we are talking about a Reddit rant here. But still, I hope you can see some of the other things that people find unpleasant about Blippi. And I'm not saying that just based on that Reddit rant. Nope. If you actually search around on the internet, you'll find parents even talking about how they just don't like his vibe from the jump without even having learned about the Harlem Shake thing. Anyway, the reason I brought up that Reddit thread is because of one of Blippi's critical skill sets, SEO specialist. Right from the start, before he even made the Blippi channel, it seems like Steven was committed to finding ways to go viral through entertainment. I actually like how BuzzFeed phrased it. They said, "Beneath the surface, Blippi and Steezy Grossman share two traits, a willingness to debase themselves, be it clownish antics or taking a literal dump for entertainment, and a methodical, calculated effort to use social media and its algorithms to reach as many eyeballs as possible." In short, he would go to any lengths to go viral. This ties in really well with him being an SEO specialist in his past. SEO means search engine optimization, and an SEO specialist is a job where a person essentially learns how a search engine like Google works in terms of ranking content, and then tries to use that knowledge to rank their content high on search results. YouTube uses that same idea, except it's ranking YouTube videos. So Blippi, with such knowledge of ranking factors, almost had the secret sauce when it came to making viral content. As he explains in an interview, he gave the channel, quote, "a good foundation of SEO."
That is more so giving it a good foundation of SEO, and then from there creating more and more videos with a good foundation of SEO.
Once he had that going, it was just a matter of spamming videos. Now, in case you're still lost of what I'm talking about here, think of it this way. For example, if kids are searching up Skibbity Toilet on YouTube, how would you get them to find you? Well, you make a video revolving around Skibbity Toilet. There's a chance you'll appear in the search results. They wouldn't click on a video, you know, my vlog, my trip to the mall. You gotta hop on trending topics. It's almost how I blew up. It's exactly how I blew up. You just hop on trending topics, but he did it in a crazy way in terms of kid trends, like very niche things. I don't know how else to describe that. You can do your own research on SEO, especially when it comes to children's content, but that's a different world. It's the same YouTube algorithm, but it's just a different world. Because I feel like kid trends just last for years. Like there are still kids watching Baby Shark videos, you know? The point here is that whether it was poop videos or making content for children, he's a smart dude. Remember that even his Harlem Shake video had its own website, www.harlemshakepoop.com. And this was back in 2013 when websites weren't that easy to make. TechCrunch did actually publish an article showing just how much search traffic the term Harlem Shake was getting at the time. Now, also worth mentioning is that with a background on SEO and online marketing, it's no wonder that Blippi could see an opportunity in the market and take it. One neat trick SEO specialists use is that if you search for a specific phrase and nothing of value comes up, that's a sign they can create content around that phrase and rank first on Google's platform.
platforms. That's exactly how Steven's channel started. He says, "My two-year-old nephew wanted to watch tractor videos online, but all we could find was, well, garbage. The videos certainly weren't educational. I wanted to bring positive emotions and experiences to the act of learning. I wanted to share my curiosity with others. I wanted to make videos my nephew would be both entertained and educated by." His bet on children's content was also based on the lack of good content on YouTube. He explains that most of the good content back then was just on cable. Free content was not good. And he gives the example of tractor videos that had nothing other than just tractors with background music. Pre-2014 era YouTube wasn't much of a career for many people. There were a few lucky ones that a lot of us watched, but that was it. So it was obvious that because people saw it as a fun platform, they didn't put too much thought into the production quality of their content. Times were just different. Music videos were leading in views, for instance. Now Mr. Beast can get more views than a mainstream artist on a couple videos. Hashtag not my Blippi. Now let's wrap this up by highlighting some of the recent, or maybe not so recent, drama facing the Blippi brand. And honestly, there's not much to it other than the addition of a new Blippi actor. But this has come with resistance from many parents. The new guy, Clayton Grimm, says he ended up in the position because he'd been hired to play Blippi in Blippi the Musical after auditioning 4 times. Yeah, there's also a musical. This was back in 2019. Steven had apparently decided to look for a second Blippi so he could make more videos. Out of necessity, Grimm went from playing the musical to being flown to LA to make content, and soon enough, he was everywhere that the original Blippi had been. We're talking about Hulu, HBO, Netflix, etc. Now, like I said, the drama was that some parents just resisted the fact that there was a new Blippi actor. Even though he wasn't taking it over, he was just filling in sometimes. Under the hashtag NotMyBlippi, you can find videos all talking about the parents' dissatisfaction. Apparently in the comments, some of the moms even implied that Grimm was the Wish version of the real Blippi. Kids were also not left behind in expressing their disappointment. Yup, and that's really it for this video. Make sure to leave a like if you enjoyed, subscribe if you think I'm swag, and yeah, that's the story of the most disgusting children's entertainer out there. All we can do now is wait to see if his past will go back into the dark, it won't, or if it'll haunt him forever. It probably will. And I also want to say that this hoodie is going to be on sale soon. If not, it's already on sale. Make sure to follow me on Instagram if you want updates on my life and stuff. But yeah, so this is a collab hoodie with 2 other brands, so there's Earl right there, there's Puffy, and this is First High. So make sure to go check it out if it's already out, but just go follow me on Instagram if you're cool. Anyway, that's it for this video. I have a new single that's already out, so go check that out. I'll see you guys next time I upload.